Now, I'd like to also bring up our second honoree of the evening. First, introducing her is someone many of us know who helped build this hotel. Please welcome Elaine Wynn. Everybody, I am very pleased to join all of you this evening in honoring these two exceptional women. I have the pleasure, of course, to talk about a dear friend. Her parents created a self-fulfilling prophecy when they named their daughter Lovee. The quality that permeates her every action is love of her family, of her friends, and of course of her community. From the first day I met Lovee, when I was a transplanted mother, moving to a very strange town, Lovee opened her heart to embrace me and my family in much the same way she has done for so many others that came here throughout the years. She's extended this same personal commitment to hundreds of relationships to improve the lives of people she knows and others who she may not know, but who may need help. Of the many organizations, and again, they are referred to in your program, I do want to single out that she supported several that have benefited from her special focus. First and foremost, in the early years, of course, Junior League commanded her attention. The mission was and continues to be a very compelling one. It's to evaluate existing resources in a community and then to help create sustainable social service agencies to build a city. The Nathan Adelson Hospice in Las Vegas was one of the first hospices in the whole country. Responding to the leadership of her dear friends, Erwin and Susie Malowski, Lovee quickly signed on to assist in the development of this compassionate and humane institution. Valuing Lovee's judgment, another close friend, Larry Ruvo, sought her out to work with him on creating the Cleveland Clinic Lou Ruvo Center. What many of you may not know is that Lovee accompanied Larry as they traveled to the premier medical centers around the country to research and recommend the best possible partnership. As a result, we're also proud to have the world-renowned Cleveland Clinic here in Las Vegas. Her tireless effort has been consistent in her work on the Keep Memory Alive benefit every year. As a seasoned philanthropist and community leader, Lovee was a natural to help the recently created Nevada Women's Philanthropy Group. Comprised of an impressive collection of accomplished women, this organization is targeting areas of critical needs centered around children. Lovee's been generous with both her time and her resources throughout her life, not only in Las Vegas, but places around the country as well. The people who have had the good fortune to be in her life know about Lovee's wonderful personal qualities. She's a devoted wife and companion to an indefatigable impresario, Bob Arum. And she's a loving mother and grandmother to her children and grandchildren. She's the model for a friend who is there in times of need with a good deed. It's these human qualities that are markers of a true humanitarian. Someone whose sense of caring and compassion for those closest people in your life is always the one who extends those qualities and commitments to a greater audience. It comes as no surprise to those of us who have benefited from having Lovee in our lives that others would acknowledge and honor her tonight. There are not many people in this world who have the consistency of deep, deep caring that Lovee has. I am so proud to introduce Lovee Arum as the recipient of the, I wasn't going to do that, of the Florence Lee Jones Humanitarian Award. of ceremony, so Lovee, I must hand you this, and then you can have the microphone. That was overwhelming, Lovee. Thank you so much. That's what friends are for. Late yesterday afternoon, my daughter Dina came to visit me after her return from the Philippines. She asked what I planned for my remarks tonight. She was emphatic that I own up to two things. The first, how many years I've been in Germany. I had obviously left that out for reasons that you can imagine. So, I entered Junior League as a provisional in 1968, when Las Vegas was referred to as a town. In the 1970s census, Las Vegas trumpeted a population of 125,000, with all of Clark County only 273,000. Now, that record's straight. The other thing Dina insisted that I make a confession to an experience I had many years ago. Here goes. In my early days of League, I volunteered at the thrift shop for 17 three-hour shifts in downtown Las Vegas. Wait. Around 1971, I reached a point that I could train a provisional. On this particular afternoon, during my training session, a man walked in wearing a striped Las Vegas uniform. He searched the shop until he found an outfit he fancied. I directed him to the dressing room where he could try on the clothes. When the man emerged, I thought he looked terrific. He approached us at the counter, reached into his pocket, pulled out a Bull Durham pouch, and paid for the clothes. When it came time to close the shop, I walked into the dressing room and found the man's striped uniform on the floor. I thought, what a great Halloween costume. But as I picked it up to fold, I read the label, Las Vegas Prisoner. My first thought was, what will the price tag be on this uniform? But then I realized, maybe I should call someone about this before making my fabulous Halloween purchase. I picked up the phone and called the prisoner authorities. I kindly explained the situation, and the officer on the phone said, "Lady, are you telling me that you just sold clothes to help a prisoner escape?" Ladies and gentlemen, that I did. For social responsibility, while preparing me for the very service that I am so graciously being honored tonight. At the first Christmas coffee I attended, Florence Lee Jones was gracing the end of the dining table, having the honor of pouring coffee and tea. This was a custom for past presidents and some very special pioneer women. I remember immediately being captivated by the statuesque, beautifully spoken, well-respected, extremely accomplished lady who embodied these values by example. I never imagined that I would receive an award bearing her name. Florence Lee Jones was a masterclass herself in being a pioneer woman. Her father had worked for Shell Oil instructing the use of a rotary drill in Sumatra, where Florence Lee had lived with her family. In 1931, they all returned to the United States to enroll Florence Lee into the University of Missouri. On the way back to Sumatra with his wife and two sons, they stopped in Kingman, Arizona. He was told that a dam was being built in a little town across the river. Mr. Jones took the family on a ferry across the water to look around. He surveyed the site and declared, "I am not going back to the jungle." Mr. Jones stayed and broke ground on the Jones' family lineage as great civil pioneers. He built a service station on the road to the dam and would later go into real estate. Florence's brothers, Herb and Cliff, worked their way through college without jobs on the dam site and would become prominent local attorneys. Cliff would even serve as Nevada's lieutenant governor. Florence Lee graduated from the University of Missouri in 1933 with a bachelor's degree in journalism and moved to Las Vegas to join her family. Jobs were so difficult to find at that time. Yet she was lucky enough to get a temporary job at the Evening Review Journal. Florence Lee did such a fine job that she was hired as the only full-time reporter at the newspaper. Her first assignment at the Review Journal was to cover the building of the Hoover Dam. Florence Lee was fearless. She was the only woman allowed down in that hole during the construction of the dam. Always a true renegade, Florence Lee also began secretly dating her boss, managing editor John Kalin. They quietly married in 1940, as it was against company policy to date, let alone marry a co-worker. Meanwhile, when the war ended, the women who had worked as volunteers for the American Red Cross, the USO, and Traveler's Aid wondered if their experience and abilities could be tapped to address post-war problems. Six young matrons joined together and formed the nucleus of the organization, then known as Service League, now our Junior League of Las Vegas. Florence Lee Jones served as president for the league's first 2 years. For the next 20, she covered virtually every major news story in Las Vegas. Then she was society editor, the perfect perch for her talented bird's eye view into the heart and heartiness of Las Vegas. I thank all the members of Junior League today for selecting me to receive an award in the spirit of Florence Lee Jones. As the daughter of a man that lived and worked to realize the American dream, service to others and philanthropy have always been a constant in my heart and home. Having been blessed, there was never a question that we would share and help those with lives less fortunate than our own. However, it was the Junior League that gave me the skills and seated in my heart a bountiful sense of social responsibility, as well as an ability to motivate others to share their talents through progressive, effective volunteer service. It is said that each of us has the responsibility to shape the future as we wish it to be. The leadership training that I received through the Junior League has blazed my own trail of accomplishments. I'd like to think in the spirit of Florence Lee Jones. I must give special thanks to the Bellagio Hotel and my dear friend Larry Ruvo for making tonight a grand event. A big thanks to the ladies of the Gala Committee. They are amazing. Aside from their busy lives and community projects, they work diligently on painting the town red for this evening. To each and every one of you, I thank you for your generosity in supporting the Junior League and sharing this evening with Maria and me. In closing, I would like to read a quote that I've always kept constant in my heart and mind. It has provided me guidance in the choices and paths that continue to frame my life. This is by George Bernard Shaw. I'm of the opinion that my life belongs to the whole community, and as long as I live, it is my privilege to do for it what I can. I want to be thoroughly used up when I die, for the harder I work, the more I live. I rejoice in life for its own sake. Life is no brief candle to me. It is a sort of splendid torch which I have got hold of for the moment, and I want to make it burn as brightly as possible before handing it on to future generations. Thank you all so much.